16. Well, let us fall before our God of grace. Shall we pray together? Most gracious God and our loving Heavenly Father, we approach you this morning and gladly accept your invitation to worship you for all that you are, for all that you were, and for all that you have yet to be. For only you are worthy to receive all honour and praise. For you are, as we've just sung, the rock of our salvation, the very foundation of our faith and the focus of our lives. And so we would join with all creation this morning, bowing before your sacred throne and blessing your sacred name. The name that we learn from the Bible is above every other name, and at whose name, when you return again in glory, every knee will bow and every tongue confess you as Saviour and Lord. Yet forgive us, Father, for we confess that we have so often turned and we have worshipped other gods. We've bowed down before their thrones, thrones of money, leisure, pleasure, career, status, the list is endless. We have given you second place when we ought to have given you first place and should have made you our first and top priority. And yet the good news is that you always make us your top priority. We are your chosen ones. Jesus even died so that our sins would be forgiven. So great is your love for us. So in the light of that, and much more, please change us, we pray. Help us to appreciate more of your deep love for each of us. Help us to change our habits. And like the psalmist, help us to make a joyful noise in praising you with all our hearts and with all our lives. For in you and through you is all our hope and all our joy. Father, we ask that you would receive our worship and simply enrich our lives today and every day. And hear us now, as we would gather up all our prayers in the family prayer that Jesus taught us to pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Last Sunday we looked at the importance of being honest in our lives, and especially honest before God. Today we look at how the apostles solved a problem that had arisen due to the growing numbers of members in the early church. Now, reading this morning is from Acts chapter 6, verses 1 to 7, and then John 15, verse 16. And our reader today is Tam Wild. Tam.
Choosing of the seven. In those days when the number of disciples was increasing, the Grecian Jews among them complained against the Hebraic Jews, as their widows were being overlooked in the daily distribution of food. So the 12 gathered all the disciples together and said, It would not be right for us to neglect the ministry of the word of God in order to wait on tables. Brothers and sisters, choose 7 men from among you who are known to be full of the Spirit and wisdom. We will turn this responsibility over to them and we will give our attention to the prayer and ministry of the word. This proposal pleased the whole group. They chose Stephen, a man full of faith and of the Holy Spirit. Also Philip, Prochorus, Nicanor, Timon, Parmenas, Nicholas from Antioch, a convert to Judaism. They presented these men to the apostles, prayed and laid their hands on them. So the word of God spread. The number of disciples in Jerusalem increased rapidly, and a large number of priests became obedient. The second reading is John 15, verse 16. You did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you so that you may go and bear fruit, fruit that will last, and so that whatever you ask in my name, the Father will give you. Amen, and thanks be to God for the reading of his word.
Thank you, Tom. Thank you. When it comes to choosing sides, someone once said that if we have Jesus on our side, we are always in the majority. The challenge for us is when the going gets tough, whose side are we on? Who will we choose? Our next hymn poses the question, who is on the Lord's side? Who will serve the King? Before we look at our passage in more detail this morning, we sing number 769 in Mission Praise. Mission Praise number 769. Let us continue to worship God together. Thank you, Christy. Thank you. Be chosen. It's now 6 weeks since we began our series entitled What Next? As we looked at the events that followed Jesus' death and resurrection, events that were key to laying the foundations for the early church, and events that we are called to learn from today. These events are recorded for us in the book of Acts. We said that although the book of Acts has been called the Acts of the Apostles, it can equally be called the Acts of the Holy Spirit, because everything that the apostles did through the power and guidance of the Holy Spirit. For what next? Well, it was a question that both the disciples and the followers of Jesus must have asked. With Jesus now gone, what was to become of them? But more importantly, what was to become of this new community, the church, that their leader had just given his life for? Our series began with God dramatically giving the Holy Spirit to the church at Pentecost, and still gives us today. We've reached our seventh and our penultimate study in the book of Acts. We will finish our studies next week. So turn with me now to the passages that Tam read for us this morning. It was from Acts chapter 6, verses 1 to 7, and then John 15, verse 16. And again, it would be so helpful for you to have a Bible beside you as we look at these verses together. Well, over these weeks, we've read of the growing growth, I suppose, of the early church. And it's been amazing, even since the day of Pentecost, when God gave the power of the Holy Spirit to the church. And still gives today. But what is the Holy Spirit, you ask? Well, the Holy Spirit is the person of Jesus, the person of Jesus living in every believer. That enables us to do things that we never thought possible before. The Holy Spirit enabled the disciples then and us today to preach, teach, pray, and heal. And they were bringing significant changes to many people's lives. The church had now a great number of followers, referred to in the opening lines of our reading as disciples. And just as Christians, we too are all disciples. The church had become successful. But let me ask you, how do you understand success? Someone once wrote that no one has ever climbed the ladder of success with their hands in their pockets. So true. Success only comes with commitment and with hard work, doesn't it? The problem was that all this hard work and success had resulted in a bit of a crisis for the early church. So nothing is new. The problem was that the 12 apostles were trying to do everything themselves. They had committed themselves to preaching and teaching as a priority. But this meant that other tasks were not being carried out. Practical needs, like dealing with the finances and the care of the widows, were being ignored. And this had all led to a quarrel. So here we have the very first dispute in the church. And what was it about? Well, it was partly about money. So nothing really changes, does it? Help was urgently needed. Hence the appointment of 7 men or 7 helpers. Stephen, who was the first member of the early church's congregational board. And we'll look at him more in detail next week. And in a sense, the apostles were the kirk session. They were dealing with spiritual matters. And Stephen, Philip, and the others were appointed to deal with matters of fabric and finance. I suppose they were the congregational board. So it just goes to prove that kirk session and congregational board meetings, just like the one we held on Tuesday evening, they've been around for some time. Let's look at how this crisis was solved then. Let's look at it under the following headings. We'll look at the problem, the priorities, the principles, and then finally we'll look at the practical and spiritual solution. So what was the problem? As the gospel was being preached in the power of the Holy Spirit, many were being converted to Christianity. But in the church, a disagreement had broken out between the Grecian Jews, Greek-speaking Jews, and the Aramaic-speaking Jews. They were the Hebrew Jews. The problem was that the Greek-speaking Jews began to complain that their widows were not getting their fair share of the food and money that the apostles were distributing each day to the needy in the church. Remember our study in fellowship last week? We learned that those in the early church had sold all their possessions and they'd given the money over to the apostles to distribute it equally. Everything was shared. And as I said earlier, at the root of the problem was, unsurprisingly, money. So nothing changes. So what were the priorities of the early church and of the disciples and the apostles particularly? The apostles saw their priorities, secondly, to carry out what they had been appointed to do. They were carried out to preach, teach God's word, and pray. But they had become too busy, with the result that the widows had become neglected. We can become too busy in the church as well, can't we? And we can neglect those that we've been called to serve and care for. I can recall a time when I had become so pressurized at work, with commitments also in the church, that my family had become neglected. And it wasn't a happy time, and I was forced to rethink my priorities. But we also must be careful not to overload or overburden those in leadership among us. And I think this could not be more relevant as the Kirk session and as the Congregational Board consider ways forward to reopening our church buildings. You see, we cannot grow in faith if we are distracted by other matters. I've always valued this saying or warning. It says, busyness. Busyness is the enemy of holiness. And whenever we mention the word enemy, we must not forget that our enemy, Satan, is never far away. And just like Ananias and Sapphira last week, we must be aware of Satan's influence in the church and his subtle incursions into our lives. It was therefore necessary that the church take measures to protect these priorities. So thirdly, we consider the principles that were used to guide the apostles into solving this problem. Well, the apostles' guiding principles were very clear. We read in verse 2b, they state, it would not be right for us to neglect the ministry of the word of God in order to wait upon tables. And in verse 4, it says, we will give our attention to prayer and the ministry of the word. They did not consider the need to serve others less important, but not just as important as preaching and teaching and prayer. For these were the principal responsibilities of the apostles. That is what they were appointed by God to do. And in their view, these responsibilities were not being satisfied. There was a difficulty, so something practical had to be done. We're going to pause here and we're going to listen to a song that reminds us as to who we must turn to in our times of difficulty. We must turn to Jesus, who never lets us down, who because of his love, and in the words of our song, always holds us fast. So let's listen and reflect on that wonderful promise before we continue.
Special life, bought by heaven. Christ will hold me fast. Justice has been satisfied. He will hold me fast. Raised with him to endless life. He will hold.
The apostles, they needed to solve the complaint of the widows that had arisen while exercising their responsibilities to God. So what did the Holy Spirit do to lead them? Well, look at verse 3. Verse 3 says that the apostles instructed the gathering of the disciples, and they instructed them to appoint 7 men to turn this responsibility over to them. The solution? Well, as every good leader knows, always lies in delegation. The solution was to appoint 7 men. But these men had to have special authorities and qualities that we too must also possess if we are to be appointed to any office within the church. And great discernment was needed in choosing these candidates. You ask, what were these qualities? Well, verse 3 says that they would be those who are known to be full of the Spirit and wisdom. These men who would become the first deacons in the church. So they had to display a godly life and demonstrate wisdom. How does the Bible define wisdom? Well, if we look at Proverbs 1, verse 7, it says, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. Or you may prefer John Bunyan's version and warning when he says, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom, and they that lack the beginning have neither a middle nor an end. What is the fear of the Lord? It is to have that primary qualification, namely, to be filled with the Holy Spirit. Every leader in the church must be filled with the love and fear of God if he or she is to be effective, bring honour to God and blessing to others through their service and witness. But did you notice that the names of the 7 that were chosen, they all had Greek names? They were Greek-speaking Jews. And you remember that the original complaint had arisen from those who were Grecian Jews. Now, was this just a smart diplomatic move by the apostles? Well, not completely. Let's look at finally how they were chosen, and in particular, who did the appointing. And to this, we consider the verse that Tam read for us earlier from John 15, verse 16, where Jesus says this, "You did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you to go and bear fruit, fruit that will last." Throughout our series, we have seen how the Holy Spirit enables us to do things that we never thought possible. The ability to change others, to heal others, speak boldly before others, pray powerfully for others, to live together with others, and remained honest before others and before God. This morning we've seen yet another gift of the Holy Spirit, and that is to guide us when we appoint those to key positions within the church. The disciples sought the help of the Holy Spirit to guide them to those men, and in doing so, it was Jesus who was actually choosing them. And when you think about it, these men would have been the leaders in his church. So Jesus not only had a key stake in this matter, but he would certainly have to ensure that those to be chosen were of the right qualifications and caliber. At such times, we too must hand these tasks over to God in faith, for he does the choosing of us. But more, he never makes a mistake. But how do we do this, you ask? How do we hand this matter over to God? Well, verse 6 tells us. It says we do it in prayer. The appointment was confirmed by the apostles laying their hands on the new leaders and praying for them. Now, this was originally a Jewish practice. We read about it in the Old Testament book of Numbers. And it is one that has become customary in our own church tradition. And you'll see it especially when you attend ordination services, especially of those for ministers. And it is believed that such a practice is necessary to obtain the full blessing of the Holy Spirit. In doing so, these leaders were being commissioned. They were being ordained, set apart for God's service and God's glory. But what was the consequence of these appointments? We read that many similar appointments followed, because in our closing verse 7 it says, the number of disciples in Jerusalem increased rapidly, and a large number of priests became obedient to the faith. The church grew, with many people converting to Christianity. And why was this? It was because God was blessing the church, and the Holy Spirit was active and proactive in choosing men and women, and all in a response to prayer. The church was growing. As John writes, the members were truly doing God's work. They were willing to go out and bear fruit. They were obeying God's will, and in doing so, Jesus was promising to give them whatever they asked for in my Father's name. Friends, there is only one way to bring glory to God and for us to share in that glory ourselves, and that is by the way of faithful obedience. For it is only when we are obedient will we obtain answers to our prayers. People will be changed and the church will grow. And we share in the privilege and responsibility, because Jesus by the Holy Spirit has chosen us. He's appointed us for this glorious task. Jesus, he's chosen you and he's chosen me to work for his church. Now that is a wonderful encouragement to us all this morning. We've read that God through the Holy Spirit was continuing to bless the church. And they all lived happily ever after, you ask? Well, not quite. For as the church grew, so did the opposition. But you'll just have to come back next week to learn more about that. Shall we pray? Loving Father, we thank you for the church. Thank you that we are your chosen and precious people. Thank you that you care for the church, appoint leaders to maintain it, protect it, and grow it. But Father, we confess with much sadness that we see so little growth in the church today. Our earnest prayer is that you would continue to choose those whom you would choose, those who are full of the Spirit. So lead us forward and upward, so that the Church of Scotland may be revived and restored in these difficult days, and all to your glory. Lord, hear our prayer, the prayer that we make in Jesus' name and for his sake. Amen. Before our closing prayer of intercession, we sing a hymn that asks for the Holy Spirit to come and make many more in Scotland members of the Church, and also those in Knightswood, those who will be chosen and equipped for worship and service. We sing number 626 in the Church Hymnary. Holy Spirit, truth divine, dawn upon this soul of mine. Let us worship God together.
Holy Spirit, truth divine, dawn upon this soul of mine. Word of God and inward light, wake my spirit, clear my sight. Holy Spirit, love divine, glow within this heart of mine. Kindle every high desire, perish self in thy pure fire. Holy Spirit, power divine, fill and love this will.
Shall we pray? Loving Father, at our joint Kirk session and board meeting earlier this week, we discussed the guidance documents issued for the possible reopening of our church. And we confess that instead of bringing us comfort, they brought us much fear and anxiety. Together we prayed for wisdom to be granted for the many discussions that will be required to ensure a possible safe return to our church. So we come to you as the one who has promised to grant us wisdom if we ask for it in faith. So we pray that you would guide all those who will take important decisions on our behalf. We pray for the Kirk session and the congregational board. And this morning, particularly pray for David and for Janet and for Wilma. We pray for wisdom to not only reopen our church when the time is right, and the time to be safe to do so as well. For we long to worship you again in meaningful ways, ways that will bring us blessing and in ways that will bring glory to your name. Lord, grant us to love one another. Grant us to exercise patience and understanding during these difficult days, we pray. Lord Jesus, as we heard earlier, you're the one who holds us fast, the one who never lets us down, the one who never disappoints. And so we thank you for all that is happening in these days to protect us, to guide us and cure us, and allow us to safely return to normality again. And yet we do this with much sadness and anxiety in our hearts as we remember all those who have died, all those who are still suffering symptoms, and others suffering from the various side effects of this virus. Lord, simply help us to place all our trust in you, the one who holds us fast. Finally, we rejoice in the many who are continuing to give of themselves for our benefit in so many ways. And we would ask you, Lord, to bring them so much blessing today as we give you our thanks for them. Now go in peace to love and serve God. And may the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all and all whom you love and pray for this day and forevermore. Amen. Friends, thank you again. It's been my privilege. Thank you for joining us this morning, and may God bless you all.
Thank you, John.